Praise the Lord. Church, are you glad to be in God's house on a beautiful Sunday morning? I think we need to all stand to our feet and begin to lift up the name of our God. We serve a great big God on a Sunday morning, and we ought to magnify him. God has shown up for church and is going to do something special this morning, and I think we ought to magnify him this morning. Let's give God some praise.
Jesus, we lift you up.
more. Come on, church, let's do that right now. Let's give God a good hand clap of praise on a beautiful Sunday morning. Praise the Lord. It is good to be in God's house. Did you come excited for what God is doing? Praise the Lord. I think we ought to magnify God, not for what he's done, not for what he's doing, and not for what he's going to do, but just because of who he is. Praise the Lord. In spite of my circumstances, my God is still alive and well. In spite of the struggles that you may be facing, your God is still able. And I think we ought to magnify God on this Sunday morning. Praise the Lord. Let's give God one more good hand clap. Hallelujah. God, you're faithful to us, Jesus. Lord, we magnify you. Praise the Lord. It feels good in God's house. You can be seated just for a few moments. It is good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. I want to welcome you to Center First this morning. We're looking forward. We are excited about what God is doing, and we're looking forward to God doing some amazing things this morning. If you are a guest with us this morning, whether here in person or online, we want to welcome you to the house of the Lord. We want you to join right in and help us as we magnify our God. Praise the Lord. It is exciting to be living for God in 2024. We're living in uncertain times. The Bible says there is no new thing under the sun. So I believe that God has seen where we are in time and in history, and he knows how to bring us through. But we're living in uncertain times, and I want to be found standing on a firm foundation. I want to be found standing on the rock that is Christ Jesus. I want to be found standing in the house of the Lord, looking forward and putting myself in a place where God can do some things for me as an individual and for our church. And I think God is going to come down and bless this morning. Praise the Lord. But we want to make sure that we are all welcome here in the house of the Lord, and we're looking forward to God doing some good things. Praise the Lord. You have been a faithful church through the years in your tithing and your offerings. God has blessed as you have given to the work of the Lord. God is going to continue to bless you as an individual and bless this church as you give to the work of the kingdom. The tithing and the offering boxes are located at the back of the sanctuary. You can give as you're coming and going. You can also give on the church app. And on the church app, you can also keep up with a lot of the announcements, a lot of things that are happening around our campus. Praise the Lord. We are not sitting still. We are moving forward into a bright future. And that tells me also one more thing that's on my brain. We have Tuesday night, everybody say prayer meeting. Tuesday night, 7 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. Speaking of moving forward into a bright future, we're going to gather together as a church and pray that God would come down and bless our church. God would give us direction and wisdom and move us forward into the revival that he has specifically for this church individually and also for the church as a whole. That is Tuesday night at 7 p.m. If you have not been here for a Tuesday night prayer meeting, you need to do yourself a favor and be here this coming Tuesday. Praise the Lord. There are several jars on the back countertop area at the Welcome Center back there. There is a fundraiser going on for our young people for various things they've got going on, and it's called Kiss the Pig. My face and my name happens to be on one of those jars, and whoever gets the most money put in their jar has to kiss a pig. It concerns me that Brother Buddy said it's not going to be something like off Charlotte's Web. Those are my words, not his. It's not going to be something cute and cuddly like Wilbur, but it's going to be a real pig. Praise the Lord. That kind of concerns me a little bit. He asked me to make this announcement and make this push for you to put money in those jars, and I want to admonish you and I want to encourage you, give to the work of the Lord by putting money in the jars out there for Kiss the Pig. Praise the Lord. Just avoid the one that has the guy with the hat on. Don't put any money in that jar. If I understand correctly right now with our young people, Aiden, you got the lead at the moment, brother. I lost you, but I don't know where you are now, but you got the lead at the moment. Praise the Lord. It's coming, brother. It's coming. And I am excited to inform you currently, Pastor Winslow is leading among the men. Praise the Lord. Now, it's all in good fun. It is all in good fun. We're looking forward to God doing some great things through that fundraiser. So please, put money in those jars that is going to our young people, going to our Wired Student Ministries. We're looking forward to God doing some good things, and that's going to be a fun time. Praise the Lord. And I'm going to be excited when Aiden and Pastor have to kiss that pig. Praise the Lord. Are you glad to be in God's house? Did you come expecting God to do some things? Someone told me recently that we get what we expect when we come to church. And I came expecting God to do something on this beautiful Sunday morning. We're coming up on Independence Day this coming week, where we celebrate our freedom as a country. But I'm excited about the freedom and the liberty that is in the house of the Lord. The Bible tells us where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And I'm excited about the liberty that I feel in the house this morning. And I need God to bless. You need God to bless. We need God to bless as a church. And I believe that God's going to come down this morning. And I think we ought to stand one more time. We're going to go right back into worship. We're going to continue to lift up the name of our God. And I would admonish you this morning, if you've got something that you need from our God, He is alive and well. He is able. He is not intimidated by your circumstances. He is not intimidated by the things that you may be facing. And I just firmly believe where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And God is going to move this morning. And I think we ought to magnify Him some more in Jesus' name. Let's give God some praise.
Covenant keeping God. Pray in the name of Jesus right now for healing in the house. If you need a healing in your body, I want you to raise your hands to heaven. Come on, all across this place, get with somebody. If you see somebody by themselves, get with them. We're going to pray in the name of Jesus Christ for healing in this house. Come on, we are, the song says, we have a covenant-keeping God. And that covenant-keeping God is a God that can heal. Hallelujah. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we speak into this place right now. God, you see your people. You see every sickness. You see every disease. You see every health condition. God, you see every doctor's report, every hospital visit that's coming up. And we declare, God, that you are a covenant-keeping God. And God, you keep your word. And everything that you said in your word will come to pass. You said, I'm the God that healeth thee. You said, I'm the God that's with you even until the end of the world. You said, you never leave us. You never forsake us. You said, it's by your stripes that we are healed. You said, lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So as we pray for one another, we are standing in that place of faith, declaring as we pray for each other, they shall be healed. They shall be restored. They shall be made whole. In Jesus' name, sickness has to leave. Disease has to leave. Health issues have to be reversed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. Amen. Would you give God a great hand clap of praise in the house? What a wonderful presence of the Lord that's in this place. And it is good to see everybody here this morning. Brother Bartley said it, expectation. Anybody come expecting God to do something great in your life this morning? Amen. Amen. Thank you, praise team. Amen. What a wonderful presence of the Lord that's in this house. Let's not lose that, what we feel in God's presence this morning. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. I'm going to get into the word of the Lord in just a moment. But before we do that, I would like to give an opportunity for some of our Wired students to share. This past week, they spent some time at camp in Lufkin. And from the reports and from the pictures and all that has been shared, it was a wonderful time. And it is that God has touched them and blessed them and God has moved. And how many of you remember when you went to camps and God spoke to you, maybe gave you a purpose, gave you a vision, gave you a calling? But how many remembers going to church camp? Would you raise your hand and remember how profound those were in your life? Amen. And of course, you have a good time and you have fun and you do all those things. But the most important thing, and you connect with other people, but the most important thing is that the Word of God is imparted into our students. And they come back on fire for God. They come back with their focus, and we thank God for that. And so it is that I have asked some of our young people to come and just share whatever they want to share about their experience, about what God's put upon their heart. And so if you guys would go ahead and all of you would make your way up here to the platform, and I want them just to share their experience of what God did for them, and share with us so we know. And we want to say to everybody, every parent, parents, thank you for sending them. I tell you, thank you, Mom and Dad, for believing in camps, and this church for believing in camps. And if you volunteered in any of our camps, junior camps and all of our camps this year, if you volunteered, would you stand to your feet in any capacity that you volunteered at our camps? Would you stand to your feet? I know we've got some that volunteered. Amen. I don't see them here this morning, but thank you, whoever you are. Praise God. But we are so thankful that we have a church that believes in our camps. And so I want to, at this time, to turn it over. Who wants to go first? Caleb, come on, man, in Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give him a round of applause.
So this is my second year of camp, but also my last, and I wish I could go another year. I'm also very glad it ended the way it did. I mean, God was moving in all of the services. I would say almost every service, people were getting drunk and refilled with the Holy Ghost. James Wilson really spoke out to me in a message saying, and my feelings, and when God is made to make. He preached about how people are putting their feelings too much into their worship. Like, no matter what happens, you should give God praise. And no matter how you feel, you should also give God praise. And when James Wilson says, when God is made to make, he's saying that when you think there's no way out of where you're at, God is making a way for you. So never assume that he's not there making a way for you. Although I'm glad camp ended how it did, I wish I could go another year, but camp was probably the best experience I've had in a long time.
For me, camp was an amazing experience for me this year. The church services were incredibly powerful. By far, my favorite one was the impossible friendship of David and Doeg. It talked about how sometimes you have to make sacrifices and things in your life to make a better version of yourself. My favorite aspects of camp were definitely the church services and spending times with my friends in the cafeteria and the dorms. The messages this year truly resonated with me and touched my heart.
I had an amazing time at church camp. I had a lot of fun making friends. And with my friends, I beat the biggest dude at camp, so that got me a lot more friends. The church services were so powerful. You could feel the Holy Ghost so strong in every one of them. No one hesitated to worship God, and each message was something I needed to hear. Three of them that really touched me was Face to Face, Empowered But Not Forsaken by Edwin Cicada, The Impossible Friendship of Doeg by James Wilson. This was my last year of camp. I'm glad I was able to go because God moved so greatly and I left filled.
Thank y'all so much. I'm seated. Amen. Amen. What an exciting time. I thought a few times sneaking over there and checking things out because as a minister, you have free access. We gave Gray that opportunity to have some freedom. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're so glad. We're so thankful for what God is doing in our youth group. Amen. How many are thankful for the leadership of Brother Buddy and Sister Moore? Amen. Thank you. Seems like every service that they have in the Wire Student Ministry, just seems like God's moving. And God's doing great things. And that's encouraging, isn't it? Because this society and this world wants to rob our students and our teens and our next gen. and those in their 20s. This world wants to steal and rob them from us, but we are in good hands with a youth group that's on fire for God. I'm telling you, they didn't have to go, but they went because they're on fire for God, and the pictures we saw of them magnifying God. You know what I love about this church and our young people is that every time you see photos, our young people are always right in the front. Every service. Yeah, that's good. Every service. And I know that that doesn't always necessarily mean that because you're in the very front that, you know, you're more holier than somebody. That doesn't mean that. But it is interesting that every time I see photos or I do participate in one of those services, our young people are in the front, and that just lets us know they're hungry for God, and they want to get right there in the front and worship God. And I'm going to tell you, our church is in good hands with that generation that's coming after us. Somebody say hallelujah. And so I just want our young people to know and the Moors to know that we appreciate them, and we just thank God for them pouring into our young people and showing dedication to our young people, and we're just thrilled for their leadership and our young people just reaching in. As a couple of them said this is their last year of going. I remember the last year that I went, and there's good memories in that. I want to speak to us today. Before I move on, I want to say something here, and I actually want her to stand to her feet. We had something that happened at camp, and I know she thought I was about to glaze right over that, and look down at my notes. Hallelujah! And somebody say, "Thank God for notes." And we had something really awesome happen this year at camp. Every year what they do at camp is they select a group of students from the girls and a group of students from the boys, and they have nominations that are presented for Camper of the Year for the girls and Camper of the Year for the boys. And so a few days ago, I think it was Thursday, I received a phone call from HQ, hallelujah, and they said, "We have some great news we want to give," and they said that we have one of your students that has been nominated for Camper of the Year. Now, before I even knew who it was, immediately as a pastor, you're excited about that because that just shows what an awesome church you have, and of course you're excited. But I have to admit, I was a little more excited when I found out who it was. And so, Sister Kylie Whiteside was nominated to be Camper of the Year, and she was runner up this year. Would you stand? I'm gonna make you embarrassed. Would you turn around and wave? There you go. Thank you. And I will say that I am a little bit shocked that she did not get up today and share something. And it was all the boys, all the men that shared. But Kylie, we are so proud of you. And I know her parents are so thrilled and proud of her. And what was shared with me is the heart she has. And for not only for God, but it's not easy to be nominated for Camper of the Year. I thought it was just, you know, you shout, maybe run the aisles a few times, give a hallelujah so they can hear you. But it's pretty hard to be nominated. There's a lot that goes into it. And then they told me there's an interview of some sort that took place. And I'm thinking, oh my Lord, they're really advanced now. You know, back when I was growing up, if you picked up trash, you know, you could be nominated. Amen. You kept your dorm clean. And now there's this really extensive process. And the fact that she was nominated. And then I believe you got a $500 scholarship for TBC that was added to her as well. And so we're just proud as a church to have such wonderful, wonderful young people. Would you give it up one more time for our young people? And I promise I won't use the time we used here to go into my message. I will try to be brief. I promise I will try. Someone say try, Brother Winslow. Try. But when I spoke with Brother Williams about it, I said, you know what? I can't think of a more perfect person who would get this award. I said her love for God and her character and integrity speaks for itself. And I said she is a wonderful part of our church. and he just concurred. And so we're so excited about that. And maybe we'll get her some other time to speak. Amen. We're not going to let her off the hook. All right. I want to speak to us tonight, and I want to simply title this The Intersection of Time and Purpose. The Intersection of Time and Purpose. In my time of prayer the past few days, the Lord began to speak to me on this subject, the intersection of time and purpose. And so I want to share some things with us, and I will hasten to what God has given me so that way we can be cautious of your time this morning. We are just a few days away from celebrating the 4th of July, and many of us have plans, and many of us are going to barbecue and celebrate this Independence Day with our family and have a good time together. And the purpose of those 13 colonies were that they wanted to be independent from Great Britain. And they wanted to establish themselves as a separate nation. And that is why we celebrate Independence Day, because that is the founding and the beginning of our nation, that we are independent from Great Britain. And so in pondering and thinking upon the 4th of July and that Independence Day and what we are going to celebrate, I began to think about the subject of purpose. Purpose. And it was then that the Lord began to speak to me about the intersection of time and purpose. Time and purpose. Purpose is and has been a very popular subject in our world. Books by the thousands are written every year. It seems like when you walk into Barnes & Noble, you walk into Walmart, you walk into bookstores, there is a new author and there is a new book with a title, but the subtitle is Finding Your Purpose, finding what you were created to do, finding why you are here. It is a very popular subject. And these books by the thousands, they are helping to guide people into discovering what is their purpose. That's what I want to talk to us about today. The famed novelist Mark Twain, he said this famous quote. He said, "The two most important days in a life are the day that you are born and the day that you discover why." The day that you are born and the day that you discover why you were born. I would say to us that that is true, that that is so important. Every year we celebrate our birth. We celebrate that day of when we came into this world. But I will say to each of us that our purpose and the reason why we are here and the reason why you breathe and walk this life is one of the greatest revelations you can receive. Purpose. Would you say purpose? In the book of Acts chapter 9, We see a powerful story around purpose, around the subject of purpose. It's the story of the Apostle Paul. Many of us know this story, but let me just walk us through it for just a moment in an abbreviated version, if I could. The opening of this chapter, we see that the Apostle Paul, he is declaring threatenings. He is breathing threatenings. He is bringing slaughter against the disciples of Jesus Christ. He is intending on bringing destruction to anything that Jesus touches. He has a letter that he received from the high priest, and this letter, it has given the Apostle Paul the permission to go into the villages and to find those, whether they be a woman or a man. And he would find them and he would be able to arrest them and bring them before the council, and they would be in position to be prosecuted. And so it is that he is out there looking for those that were, the Bible says, were of this way. This way is a reference to the title, The Way, which is given to the followers of Jesus. It was their title before they were called Christians. It was in Antioch that they were first called Christians, but before that, they had this title called The Way, those that are in the way, those that are after this way. It was those who followed after Jesus Christ. If Paul found them, he would bring them to Jerusalem to face those judges. It is at this point that Paul, on the road to Damascus, he encounters Jesus. We know the story, but let me say it like this. He is heading in one direction, but God has different plans. And so it is that on this road to Damascus, he encounters a great light. As he's riding upon that horse, that light shines from heaven and it blinds him and knocks him off onto the ground. It is there that in that blindness that he hears a voice that cries out from heaven. And that voice says, "Saul, Saul," who is Paul? "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" Now when Saul hears this, he's wondering, who am I talking to? And he cries out and says, "Who art thou, Lord?" And Jesus declares unto him, "I am Jesus, the one that thou persecutest." See, he thought he was persecuting the disciples, but Jesus said, "You're persecuting me." And then he says, "What do you want me to do? What do you want me to do?" And then the Lord speaks to him and says, "I want you to go to Damascus. And in Damascus, I want you to wait. And there will be a man who will come to you. And this man will come to you and he will tell you all that you should do." Purpose. Purpose. In other words, I have a purpose for you, Paul. I have a plan for you, Paul. I want to stop for just a moment and tell everybody under the sound of my voice, there is not one of us that are in this building that does not have a God divine blueprint and purpose that's within you. You may think to yourself, "But Brother Winslow, I don't feel like I have a purpose." But I want you to know, you do have a purpose. You may have had people tell you, "Well, I'm just not sure you're going to amount to anything." But let me just remind you that if you're breathing today, you've got a God purpose on the inside of you. Everybody has a purpose. Everyone does. Now, Paul is now in Damascus. And we read in Acts chapter 9 is where we'll pick up the story. Acts chapter 9 verse 10, we find that now after the threatenings upon the disciples and Jesus speaking to him to go to Damascus, we now see here in verse 10, "And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, 'Ananias,' and he said, 'Behold, I am here, Lord.' And the Lord said unto him, 'Arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth and hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, 'Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priests to bind all that call on thy name.' But the Lord said unto him, 'Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles.'" Would you say the Gentiles? "And kings," would you say kings? "And the children of Israel," would you say the children of Israel? The purpose of Paul is found in verse 15. His purpose and his reason. See, he thought his purpose was to go against everything that Jesus was trying to accomplish. But God said, "No, I've got a purpose in you. I've got something in you that I want you to understand and I want you to see." And so in verse 15, we see that the purpose of Paul was that he was to be a chosen vessel unto God, that he was to be one that would bear his name to the Gentiles. Now that's you and I. We are, there's the Jews and the Samaritans, and then there's the Gentiles. The Jews are that race, that people of God, and then the Samaritans were that mixture of people. And then there's the Gentiles. They were the heathens that didn't follow anything in Judaism or the God of Israel. And so he said, you're going to be the one that brings the name to the Gentiles. And you're going to stand before kings, authority, and principalities, and people that have power, you're going to stand before them, and you're going to speak also to the children of Israel, the Jews. And so here's this purpose that God has given. I want you to see this, because in the passages of Scripture that we've just read, as I begin to study this, there are four distinctives that God gives around purpose that are found in the Scriptures we just read. And I want to share them with us today, because if every single one of us has a purpose. See, now some of us, we don't think that, but you got to get it in your mind. You do have a purpose. You do have a calling. You do have a reason why you're here. And when you discover that, it makes the difference. And so if you realize you got a purpose, then it's important for us to understand some things around the purposes that God gives us. So there are four distinctives that are found in these passages of Scripture. The first one is, your purpose will always have a person. Your purpose will always have a person. Notice that Jesus did not give the purpose directly to Paul. Did you notice that? He didn't give the purpose directly to the Apostle Paul. Instead, it came from Ananias. This doesn't mean that others will tell you exactly what you are to do, because how many of you know you got to follow God for yourself, amen? You got to get in there and you got to see, what does God want me to do? But what this scripture is telling us is that it shows us that when it comes to your God-given purpose, that God will place people in your life that will help you in that purpose. That when you have a purpose and a calling of God, that it is God's design that he will sow people into your life that will speak into that purpose. They will speak into that calling. They will speak into your life. When God gives us a purpose, it will require someone in your life. Trying to fulfill your purpose in a silo all by yourself is dangerous. This is why those who are unteachable struggle to find their purpose. Why? Because when you struggle to fulfill your purpose, when you're quest to know and to fulfill your purpose, and you don't allow God to put people in your life that can speak into your life, you get disconnected, and therefore your purpose cannot be fulfilled, because we're always going to have somebody that God sows into our life. How many of you can raise your hand and say, I've had people that have spoken into my life that have helped and guided me and spoken to me that have been there for the purposes and callings in my life? Hallelujah. And so it is that we have to have those people. Now, we got to qualify them, right? We don't just let anybody speak into our life, but we have to qualify them, because there was another Ananias in the Bible. Yeah, there was. That Ananias and his wife lied to the Holy Ghost and dropped dead. But this Ananias, the Bible says, was devout, and he was a respected Jew in the community. And so it doesn't mean that anybody can just speak into your life, but when we allow those that God puts in our life and we qualify them, it allows us to enrich and expose the purposes that God has for us. Make sure the people speaking in your life are those that are devoutly following after Jesus Christ with all their heart. Someone say amen. And then from our passage of Scripture, you find that your purpose will always have a position. Not only will your purpose have a person that God will divinely sow into your life to speak into that purpose, but God will also make sure that your purpose will always have a position. You're saying, what do you mean by position? Well, in the Bible, it said to Ananias to go into the street which is called Straight. He said, if you'll go to the street that is called Straight, straight, you're going to find him looking and waiting for his purpose. What does that word straight mean? In the Greek, it is euthus. And it means a straight of direction, or straight away is what it means. In other words, the position in your purpose is going to require that you go straight away. It's going to require that you stay focused and you walk where God's telling you to walk. In other words, let me say it like this. There will be things that will sidetrack you, and there will be things that try to take you from the purpose that God has placed in you and try to get you off course. But you got to understand that your purpose will always have a position. And that position is, I've got to make sure that I keep going straight ahead, straight ahead, straight ahead. God told me what I need to do, and I'm going to stick to it. Listen, the world will try to pull you away from the purposes of God. This world will try to get in there and tell you, you got no purpose, and God has no need of you, and there's nothing for you in the kingdom. And that old world will try to creep in and pull you away. But you know what you got to do? You got to stay focused and say, no, I'm just going to keep on walking straight ahead. I'm going to keep trusting in God. I'm going to keep going straight, because I don't want to go to the left or right, because I got a purpose. I got a purpose. Isn't it amazing? As soon as you get a purpose, there's a distraction. As soon as you discover your purpose, the enemy comes in, because your purpose will always have a position. And when you have a purpose, get ready for the enemy to come and try to take it away. Because God's purposes are to be fulfilled, but the enemy knows I'm going to try to stop that purpose. And so it is that we have got to make sure that we stay focused on what God is speaking to us. If God has called you into ministry, just know I'm going to keep walking straight ahead. If God's called you into different things and given you purposes and visions and dreams, stay focused on what God has told you. Somebody say amen. Not only does your purpose have a person and your purpose have a position, but your purpose always has a praise. Your purpose always has a praise. Why is praise so important? I'll tell you why it's so important. Because it's praise is how you get connected to him. The Bible says that he went to the house of what? Judas. Now, I want you to see this. This isn't Judas Iscariot. This isn't the Judas that betrayed Jesus. This word Judas is the Greek form of the Hebrew word Judah. So when we see that the Apostle Paul went to the house of Judas, what it's actually saying is he went to the house of praise. That's what Judas is. It means praise. It means worship. And it's there that I want us to understand that when we have a purpose and we have a calling and we have something that God has given us, that we've got to understand that you've got to be a person that understands, no matter what, I've got to give God praise. Why? Because James chapter 1 and 17 tells us this. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from where? Is from where? Above. Every gift and every perfect gift, good and perfect gift, is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness in. In other words, he doesn't change. He doesn't shift. He doesn't move. Neither shadow of turning. When we praise God and we raise our hands and we worship him, when we take that place of praise, what we are doing is we are allowing that purpose in us to stay connected to the one who gave it to us. I'm trying to challenge us this morning that when we get a purpose and we discover what God's doing in our life, we got to continue praising God. We got to continue to have a position of praise. We got to continue worshiping, clapping our hands. Why? Because it's praise that keeps us connected to him. The greatest way to lose your purpose is to get disconnected from praise. The greatest way to lose sight of what God has for you is to disconnect yourself from praise. The greatest thing this church can ever do is to disconnect themselves from a place of praise. I'll tell you right now, let the devil do what he wants to do to you and challenge you. You keep praising God. I don't see the purpose yet. Hey, keep praising God. I don't see my purpose being fulfilled.
fulfilled yet, Brother Winslow. That's all right. You just keep praising God because your worship and your praise keeps you connected to Him. And He's the one that gave you the purpose to begin with. Hallelujah. The enemy knows if I can disconnect you from praise, I'll disconnect you from purpose. If I can disconnect you from praise, I'll disconnect you from the purpose that God has. Purpose grows in the incubator of praise. It's in that place of worship and praise that I give to God that my purpose begins to be enriched, and it grows and illuminates. And I'm going to tell somebody in this house, you have a purpose from God. Hallelujah. Woo, glory, hallelujah. The fourth thing is your purpose will always have a prayer. Your purpose will always have a prayer. James chapter 4 verse 2 declares, ye lust and ye have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight in war, ye have not, because you what? Ask not. Because you ask not. You ask and receive not because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your lust. In other words, God says, you don't have because you're not asking. And if you're asking, you're not receiving. It's because you're not doing it according to His will. Here's another thing, His purpose. See, purpose, it always has a prayer. In other words, we can never discover our purpose, and we sure will never fulfill our purpose if we are not plugged into prayer. I'm going to say it again. We can never discover what God has for us if we're not a people of prayer. And if you do have that purpose, we can never walk into that purpose if we're not a people of prayer. He said, Ananias, I want you to know that when you go, you're going to find the street called straight position. And you're going to ask of the house of Judas praise. You're going to go into where he is, and you're going to find him praying. Let me just say this. God could have told Paul his purpose on the street of Damascus. He could have said, I'm going to give it to you now. But God said, I want you to understand how purpose works. I want you to discover that there are some things that are involved in my purpose for you. If I just give you what it is and we just walk away, it'll die right there. So I want you to know that you need somebody, that you need each other. I want you to know, Paul, that it's not just me and you. Woo, come on, somebody. See, some of us, I've heard it before, not in here, but I've heard it before. Oh, I got Jesus, and that's all I need. We heard a song just the other day that me and Sister Winslow looked at. It was a song that said, I've got Jesus, and that's all I need. And it started going, I don't need no teacher. I don't need no neighbor. I don't need my mother. I don't need my father. I got Jesus, and that's all I need. And as soon as the song started going, we both looked at each other and went, that ain't right. Hallelujah. How many know what I'm talking about? That ain't right. Jesus was saying, hey, look, I died on the cross for you, but there are some things you need along with what I'm doing. You need somebody who'll speak in your life, Paul. You need somebody that'll reveal this to you. You need somebody that'll speak in your life. You need to be in the right position. You need to be in that place of an attitude and a focus. Because listen, God wants to give you visions and dreams and a future, but He wants to know, are you focused? Are you ready for it? Can you trust God to step out into that? And then He wants to know, are you going to be in position of praise? Because He says, hey, if I'm going to give my purpose to somebody, guess who gets the purpose? It's those who know how to worship. So I say to us, if you're looking for a purpose, check the meter of your praise. Check the meter of your worship. Check the meter of how you lift up your hands and praise God, because it's connected. And God was saying, I could give you your purpose. And some of you are saying, I just want to know what God wants. I just want to know God's purpose for my life, Brother Winslow. I just want to know God's purpose. Let me just tell you, you just stay plugged into those around you that speak into your life, and you keep yourself straight away looking ahead and trusting in God, and you keep worshiping and praising God, and you add prayer to it. In other words, you got to start asking God for it. You got to ask God for it. Prayer is the key. Now we deal with purpose. Now let's close this up with time. You see, the purposes of God are put in us. You may know your purpose or try and discover your purpose. And these four things will help guide you in making sure that you protect the purpose of God. Because here's the thing, God is a jealous God. And when God gives a vision or a purpose to you, he intends for you to protect it. And so it is in the intersection of time and purpose. We have purpose, and then we have time. Purpose, there's things you and I can do. There's things that we can add to the ingredients of taking care of purpose. But then there's time. Time's on his end. See, purpose is where we can worship and praise and keep focus and our faith high and encounter those that can speak into our life. But time is all God. It's he's the one that controls the time. And so it is that time and purpose, they come together and they intersect together. And there are those of us that are in this house this morning, you're saying, I know what God wants to do. I know what God has in my life. But I'm just wondering when. When is God going to fulfill it? Are you there? Is anybody in the house in that place where you know what God spoke to you? And you know the things God put in you. And yet you don't see it unfolding and you don't see it opening up. So what do? You simply rest in that the intersection of time and the intersection of purpose is where God will say now. Now. Proverbs 16:3 declares, commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. Another translation says it like this, thy plans shall be established. Thy plans shall be established. In other words, your purpose shall be established. When God is involved with your plans, your purpose, when God is involved with the blueprint of your life, it will be established. And we have to know that in God's timing, the purpose is always right. Can I get an amen? So you're sitting here, don't be frustrated, because God's timing is coming and your purpose. And as you worship and praise and protect that purpose, God's timing is coming. And God says, hold on. When the time comes and your purpose comes, God says, I will speak. And everything will make sense. I could go on, but I'm out of time. Would you stand to your feet? And speaking with atheists, you'll discover that because they don't believe in God, they therefore believe very little in purpose. It's not that they don't achieve things, it's just that life is purposeless. If there is no God that created us and designed us, then life loses its meaning, it loses its purpose. But the truth is that God has created every single one of us with a purpose. Now, your purpose may not be to ever get behind a pulpit. Your purpose may never be to sing in ministry. But let me just remind every one of us, you have a purpose from God. And when you walk in that purpose, when you discover, or let me just say it like this, when you say to God, God, I don't want to just go through life just haphazardly, right? Like the pinball, just pull and it bounces around. But when I say, God, I don't want to just go through life just seemingly randomlessly, but I want to know the purpose you have in my life. I want to know, what is it that you want me to do? When you begin to ask God that, and God begins to unfold it to you, it changes everything. Because every single, whether you own a business, whether you are a teacher, whether you are a parent, grandparent, student, no matter who you are, the greatest thing you can do is to ask God, why am I here and what is my purpose? What do you want me to accomplish for the kingdom? And God will begin to speak. Maybe you're here and you don't know exactly what that plan is in your life, and you don't know what his purpose is for you, and you're asking, okay, God, what is your plan? Or maybe you're here today and you do know the purpose of God in your life, but you're struggling with that unfolding process of what it is and when, the time. I'd like to ask us if we would gather together in the altar in the front, if we could together. And here's what I'm asking us today on this time together. We are going into Independence Day and 4th of July, and I'm asking us if we can do two of those four things. If we can praise and we can pray. Now you may be coming down here and you saying, Pastor, I don't know what God's purpose is for me. I don't know what it is. Then I want to encourage you in the next few moments when we lift our hands, I want you to ask God. I want you to begin to talk to God. I want you to begin to say, okay, God, what is it that you want to do in my life? What is the purpose that you have for me? And if you're here in this altar and you're saying, Brother Winslow, I know God has revealed some things to me. God has talked to me about some things. And I'm just kind of in this waiting pattern, right? Just kind of, I have an idea, but I'm just waiting for God to say now. Then I encourage you to raise your hands and offer praise. Because see, of those four things, praise and prayer are elements that have everything to do with purpose. And as we lift up our hands and we begin to pray unto God and we begin to talk to God and we begin to worship him and we begin to ask him, God, what is it in my life? God will begin to speak and God will begin to talk. And maybe there's somebody here this morning that your purpose for right now, it may not be some grand thing yet, but maybe for you the purpose that God has in your life is there's some things in your life God is saying, my purpose for you right now is I need you to walk away from some things. You got your hands on some things that's going to destroy you. And I need you to let go of those things. And so for maybe for you, it's you need to lift those hands, and maybe it's a posture of repentance. Maybe for you, it's a place where you say, okay, God, the purpose right now that you're asking me is I got some things I got to ask you to forgive me of. I got some things in my life that I got to get right with you. Because before I could ever get into that grand purpose, the purpose for me right now is I got to get some things right with you. And so I want to challenge you today, if that's you and there's things in your life and there's sins you're battling, I challenge you, ask God to forgive you today. When you raise those hands, call upon him and ask him to forgive you. The Bible says that he will forgive you of every sin. And here's the beautiful part of it. You ready? He says that when he forgives you, that he'll forgive it so far as the east is from the west, meaning that he'll never remember it again, ever again. That means that when I say, God, today maybe my purpose isn't callings and ministries and other things, but my purpose today is I got to get right with you. That's my purpose today, is to get right with God. So what do? I lift those hands and I ask God to cleanse me and forgive me of every sin. And I ask God to wash away those sins of forgiveness. And then if you have not been baptized in that wonderful name of Jesus, today's a day to say, maybe that's my purpose today. Maybe that's the reason why I came to church today, is because God said today is a day to go down in that name of Jesus. Maybe your purpose today is to be filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. Maybe that's your purpose today. Whatever it is across this place, would you raise those hands as we get ready to sing? Come on, whatever it is. Maybe you're standing there saying, okay, God, I don't know what my purpose is. Come on, just begin to talk to him. Come on, shed those tears. Come on, let him know you got a heavenly Father that loves you beyond anything you can ever imagine. Come on, he'll never judge you. He'll never mistreat you. You're in a safe place to raise those hands and just tell him, okay, God, I need to know, what's my purpose? What are you doing in my life? Come on, can you talk to him? Maybe get some things right with God this morning. Maybe your purpose is, I got to get some things right. Whatever it is, why don't you just lift those hands and open that mouth and begin to talk to him? Come on, begin to pray. Somebody pray in the Holy Ghost. Somebody begin to tell God, I'm about ready to get things right, God. I want to get my life right. I want to turn my life around, God. I'm tired of running from you. I'm tired of running from you. I need you, Jesus. And so today, God, I'm asking you, forgive me of my sins. God, take all my sins away. Everything that I've done. God, I need you today. Would you do that all across this house? Come on, let's talk to him today. And let's let him reveal that purpose in us today. Come on, that's it. Come on, that's it. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, God's bringing some purposes alive in you. Come on, God's resurrecting a purpose in somebody. Come on, somebody's bringing that dead purpose that had died. God's bringing it back. God's bringing it back to you. Come on, that's it. Lift up those hands. Come on, lift up those hands.